In our life, we have a lot of success and failure events. And as a human, we always want to evaluate the probability of getting success or failure. So today, we're going to use P to represent the probability of being success and Q to represent the probability for being a failure. But don't forget, success is always defined by ourselves. For some students, they define success is just getting an A in the subject. Or some of students might just define success is getting a pass in the subject. For me, I will define success as getting a new subscriber or a like from you. As you can see here, if we have 60% for being success, then we will have 40% getting a fail. So let's begin the experiment with rolling a dice for only 1 time. I can use the random variable x to represent the number of 6 that I might obtain. But since I only roll for 1 time, so the maximum number of 6 I will get is only 1. Or if I'm unlucky, I might get even 0.6. Or if now I toss a coin for 1 time, I can use x to represent the number of head that I might obtain. But since I'm only tossing for 1 time, so the maximum number of head I will get is 1, or unlucky is being 0. This kind of experiment is what we call as the Bernoulli experiment. And each of the observation is what we call as the Bernoulli trial. And we can say the random variable is distributed according to the Bernoulli experiment, where each of the observation have 0.167 being a success. The 0.167 here will tell us that what's the probability for getting a 6. Same thing, here we can say the random variable is distributed according to the Bernoulli experiment, where each of the observations have 0.5 probability for being success to getting a head. So how about now we're rolling the dice for 3 times. And we use the same variables to represent the number of 6 that we can obtain. But since we are rolling for 3 times, the maximum number of 6 that I might obtain is now 3 times. I might get a 2, 1, or if I'm unlucky, then I might get 0. Same thing, if I toss the coin for 2 times now, I might get the number of head for 2 times being the maximum and 0 being the minimum. So if we have the number of observation is more than 1 times, which we observe the rolling of dice for 3 times, we observe the tossing of the coin for 2 times, this is what we call as binomial experiment. Binomial experiment is nothing but just combine more than one Bernoulli trials, and this is what we call as a binomial experiment. So we can say our random variable x is distributed according to the binomial experiment, where we need to know the number of observations. So from here, we know we have 3 observations, and each of the observation has the probability of 0.167 for success to getting a 6. And same thing, we can say the random variable is distributed according to the binomial experiment, where we observe the toss of the coin for 2 times, and each of the tossing we get 0.5 probability for getting a head. So let us define Bernoulli experiment in a more formal way. If we want to know whether an event is a Bernoulli experiment, we will need to see whether they fulfill this FITS, fits. It means that the experiment must have only 1 observation, or what we call as a 1 trial. And each of the event must be independent. The previous event does not affect the probability for the next event. And all of the experiment have only 2 possible outcomes. Like just now, I define my success is getting a 6. So if I'm not getting a 6, if I get a 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5, that is going to be my failure. But since Bernoulli experiment has only 1 trial, so the maximum number of success is 1 or 0 success. Next, they have the same probability in each of the trial. It means that if now the first tossing of the coin have the probability of P being success, then the second, third, or fourth trials of the event will have the same probability. But Bernoulli have only 1 experiment, so of course it might be the same. And if we define the probability of failure as Q, then this Q is going to be constant for the entire experiment as well. But just a reminder, when we add up the probability of success and failure together, we will get 1. So we just need to know 1 of the probability. Let's say if given Q, I can find my P by using 1 minus Q. If given P, then I can find my Q by using 1 minus P. So the last thing to remind you is the random variable is distributed according to the Bernoulli experiment, and we bracket the probability for being success. Let's have an example where we say probability of getting a yes is a success event and has a probability of P, and a no has a probability of Q, which is 1 minus P. That tells us the probability distribution for Bernoulli experiment can be obtained by using this formula. P represents the probability of the random variable being a certain amount is equal to the probability of success to the power of R bracket the probability of being failure power of 1 minus R. But since we have only one trial, then we know our random variable can only be 0 or 1. Let's try to plug in 1 in our R, where this one is the probability of getting 1 success. So my R is replaced by 1, so 1 minus 1 here is becoming 0. But we learn indices, whatever to the power of 0 is 1. So this is why P times 1 is getting P. And the probability of getting 0 success is going to be the R is 0, 1 minus 0 is 1. So this is why we have 1 times 1 minus P is just 1 minus P. Where we know this is just the probability of getting a fail. So Bernoulli experiment is very straightforward. Let's have an example of probability of success is 0.1. If success is 0.1, of course we know probability of failure is going to be 0.9. So I can write down my random variable is distribute according to the Bernoulli experiment, where we have the probability of success 0.1. So what's the probability of getting 1 success? So of course we know it's just same as P. So our P here is now 0.1, is why we have 0.1. And what's the probability of getting 0 success? It's just equal to Q, which is 1 minus P. So that's all for Bernoulli experiment. Bernoulli experiment have only one trial, but most of the times the experiment have more than one trial. So it's why now we are going to conduct the binomial experiment, where the experiment consists of more than one Bernoulli trial. And the notation is written down as the random variable X is distributed according to the binomial experiment, where we need to know the number of observations and the probability of being success. So since now it's no longer only one trial, this is why our random variable can be more than one. It can be have more than one success based on how many trials that we have. So let's for example, now we have 3 yes or no questions, and all of the events are independent, which will mean that the previous result does not affect the other observation. It means that no matter what's the result of the first questions, it wouldn't affect the probability for second questions and the third questions. And as we mentioned before, binomial experiment just consists of more than one Bernoulli trials. So it means that we will only have 2 possible outcomes. So for this case, we're going to have a yes as a success and no as our failure. And if the probability of getting yes is 0.1, then this probability will stay the same for the 3 questions. It means that if the first question has a probability of getting yes is 0.1, it will stay the same for second and third questions. But since we have 0.1 for yes, then no must be 1 minus 0.1, which is 0.9. And this is also the same thing, it will stay constant for the entire experiment. And as a reminder again, P plus Q must be equals to 1. Let's have a representation of the 3 questions. So we can build a tree to know what are the possible results. So those are the possible results, and now we want to find out that what's the probability of each of them to be happen. And now we're going to update the tree with the probability of getting yes is 0.1 and the probability of getting no is going to be 0.9. Just have a recap, if you want to find the probability of event A and event B happen one after another, then we are going to use the multiplication rule. Meanwhile, if you are finding the probability of event A or event B, where we say if event A happened, then B wouldn't happen anymore. Or when event B happened, then A wouldn't happen anymore. If this is the case, we're going to use the addition rule. So now we're going to find the probability for each event. So we know, because the 3 question is happen one after another, this is why we use multiplication rules. But do you realize that most of the answer are eventually duplicate itself? We have 3 0.009 and we have 3 0.081. Is this just a coincidence? Let's have more questions. Now we have 4 questions, and if we maintain the same probability for yes and no, which is probability for yes is 0.1, the probability of no is 0.9, these are the result. As we can see here, the problem still persists, where we have the duplicate of the same result. Do you see that? We have a lot of the duplications. So is this a coincidence? I would say it's not, because if you have the eagle eyes, you can see through this one, all of the same result is eventually consists of the probability of 1 yes and 3 no. But since it's a multiplication, and we learn about the commutative law of multiplications, where we say A times B is same as B times A. This is same as we say 2 times 3 is same as 3 times 2. So this is why in the end, they have the same result. But I think you don't want to do this kind of things for every single time, right? When we have more observations, we have more duplications. So this is why we can write it down as the probability of getting 1 yes is out of the 4 observations, I'm interested in getting 1 yes. So 1 yes means the probability of yes power of 1. So if 1 yes means we have 3 no. So the probability of no power of 3. Then I will get 0.2916. Then you will say, wait a moment, this is not the same as the one just now, because the 0.2916 is a summation of all of the 4 results, which it means it simplified the calculation by a lot. They already add up all the duplicate for us. Is there any alternative? Yes, I can write down now the probability of getting 3 no, where random variable n represents the number of no that I will get. Now, out of the 4 observations, I'm interested in getting 3 no. But since I'm interested in getting no, so my probability of no is arranged to be at the front first. So 0.9 is the probability of no is power of 3, because 3 times. So if you have 3 no, means we have only 1 yes. So probability of yes, power of 1, we get same result, which is 0.2916. Either way also will do. And now, let us see why this works. Let's say now we have probability of getting yes is p, probability of getting no is 1 minus p. And that tells that the formula for the probability distributions for binomial experiment is given by this formula, where the probability of the random variable being a certain number is same as the number of observations choosing whatever event that we are interested, the probability of success, power of the event that we want, probability of the failure, times the number of event minus the one that we are interested. So let's have an example. Let's say I want to find the probability of getting 1 success event. So out of the 4 observations, I choose 1. So probability of success, power of 1, probability of failure, out of the 4 questions, minus the one that we say is success, the remaining must be the failure. This is why we get 3. It's same as the formula given. Or now, if I say, what's the probability of getting 3 no? Where now x is represent the number of no that I get. So same thing, out of the 4 observations, I'm interested in getting 3 no. Probability of no, power of 3. Probability of yes, power of 1. So this is why the formula will works. So for whoever that's curious at why we use combination instead of permutation, no worry, I got your back. I'm going to show to you why. So now let's say now we have 1 yes and 3 no, like just now, and we have 4 slots. As we know, no matter how they rearrange, they're still the same, which is the probability of 1 yes times the probability of getting 3 no. So we can say we have 4 factorial ways to rearrange themselves divided by the identical object. We have 3 identical no, so it's 3 factorial. We have 1 identical yes, 1 factorials. So this is why we have something like 4 as the answer, where we have 4 different arrangements that contain 1 yes and 3 no, which is going to be the yes, no, 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 yes, no, 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 yes, no, and no, 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 yes, right? Which is indeed, if you use 4 choose 1, it's equals to 4 as well. So this is why just now when we say probability of getting yes, if you're using 4C1 times the probability of getting yes power of 1, probability of getting no power of 3, we get 0.2916. And this is the same answer as when we are doing it manually like this. As you can see here, when you sum up all of it, we get 0.2916. So the formula will help us to simplify by a lot. And whoever still think that using combination is a fluke, let me show to you with a more convincing proof. So let's say we have two yes and three no. Where I say R1 is the number of yes I get, R2 is the number of no that I get. And I treat these five things as the object. Where I say R1 plus R2 is just N. So now R1 is 2, we have 3 no, all of together we have 5 objects, right? And we say the 5 objects can rearrange themselves divided by the 2 identical yes and the 3 identical no, right? So it's why we have like this. But now, if I rearrange my equation and I say R2 can be represented as N minus R1 so that I now eliminate one of the variables. So now I replace my R2 with N minus R1, and this formula looks quite familiar. Because why? This is the formula of combinations. You can check with my previous video where we explain the formula of the combination in details. So if I now delete the R1, it now becomes more and more familiar, which is exactly the same for now. So this is why we can conclude that indeed we are going to use the combination. It looks like a permutation, but in reality, it's the combination in disguise. So hopefully this can convince you. So now enough for the proof, let's go back to the questions. So now, we are interested to simplify all of the data here to be something more simple. So let random variable x to represent the number of yes that we can obtain. So what's the probability of getting 0 yes? So we know it's going to be out of the 4 observations, I choose to have 0 yes. So probability of getting yes, power of 0. Probability of getting no, power of 4. So this is why we have 0.6561, which is correct. This is the one that we matched. So now, how about we are finding the probability of getting 1 yes? So out of the 4 observations, I choose 1 yes. So probability of yes, power of 1. Probability of no, power of 3. So this is why we have 0.2916, which helps us to simplify the all of the result that contain 1 yes, like this one, this, this, and this. If you don't trust me, you add up everything for these 4, if you get 0.2916. The probability of getting 2 yes, as we know, out of the 4, I choose 2. Probability of yes, power of 2. Probability of no, power of 2. So this is why we have 0.0486, which is simplified the version of whatever result that contain 2 yes and 2 no. So we can delete the 6 of them. So you see, they help us to simplify by quite a lot. What's the probability of getting 3 yes? As we know, 4 choose 3, probability of yes power of 3, probability of no power of 1, we get 0.0036, which helps us to simplify whatever contains 3 yes and 1 no, which are the 4. So now the last one is probability of getting 4 yes. So 4C4 times the probability of yes power of 4, probability of getting no power of 0, this is why we get 0.001, which is the one last one. So can you see that? It's much more cleaner after using the formula for the probability for binomial distributions. So now, if you want to know what's the probability of getting less than 2 yes, less than 2 yes, you can use a number line. Less than 2 means if this is 2, we have the open dot less than 2. So it's anything below 2 is like 0 or 1. So it means now we can add up probability of 0 plus the probability of 1, because it's 0 or 1. Means if I'm getting 0 yes, then I wouldn't get 1 yes. If I get 1 yes, then I wouldn't get 0 yes. So this is why we say it's the addition rules. So now since we have the data already, we just need to plus together. So which is 0.6561, 0.2916. So we can say the probability of getting less than 2 yes is 94.77%. Next, how about now we are curious about what's the probability of getting something like this? So this symbol tells us that we do include 1, right? If you use number line, this is 1. So we include means it's a cross dot and below 1, equal to 1 or below 1. So it must be 0 or 1, which is same as the one just now, by just using the different notation of asking. So this is why we have the same result, which is 94.77%. How about now, next one, what's the probability of getting more than 1 yes? So more than 1 yes, it means that if you have 1 as in a number line, more than 1 is open dot because it's a single line, then more than 1 go to right hand side, which means 2, 3 or 4. So we're going to add up the probability of 2, 3 or 4 all together. So since we have the data, it's going to be easy to do. Just plug it in. This is why we have 5.23% of getting one yes. Is there any alternative? Let's put the answer to the side first and let me show you the alternative way. So we have the probability of getting more than one yes. Eventually, we can use the complement rule where we say we take the probability of everything, which is 1, minus of whatever that is not related. As we know, more than 1 means if this is 1, so open dot, whatever go to the right hand side, right? So it means that whatever that is 1 and below is not included in our probability. So it means that now I can use 1 minus whatever is not related. So whatever is not related is 1 or below. So 1 or below is Px equal or smaller than 1. So if you're confused with this one, you can think of like, if they give us more than 1, if I want to reverse it, I can do 1 minus P, reverse the sign. So if you reverse, go to left hand side. But if this is a single line, it becomes double line. If now this is a double line, then if you reverse, it just becomes a single line. So this is the way of thinking. So now we have equal to 1 or less than 1, so we know it's either 0 or 1. So it's why if you minus 0 or 1, I will still get the same answer. Can you see that? 5.23%. So indeed, the complement rule will work as well. So how about now, what's the probability of getting this? So this one, if I show you in the number line, which is between 2 and 4, but 2 is open dot, is not include 2, but we do include 4. So it means that it must be 3 and 4. So this is why we're going to add up the probability of 3 and 4 yes. So if you add it up by using the data above, we will get the probability of 0.37%. So now how about what's the probability of getting not more than one yes? Not more than one yes means maximum is only one yes. So it's either 0 or 1. For whoever don't understand this one, we can think of like this. We don't look at the not first. We look at more than one yes. If more than one means more than one, right? X more than one. Then only now we include the not. The not tell us that we are going to flip our sign. And if this is the single line, now it becomes double line. So this is why we get not more than one yes is something like this. So this is just means one or less than one, right? So this is why we have 0 or 1. Same as just now. If we add out the probability, we get the answer of 94.77%. So this is why we have just a different way of asking, but eventually they imply the same thing. Hey, if you have any questions or would like to see any kind of video, do leave your comments below and let me know. If you want to support us so that we could make more videos like this, the simplest way is just by sharing the video with your friends. Click the like buttons and consider subscribe to this channel. See you in the next video.